You be here. Production 624, space exploration mix, take one.
Let it be clear that I am asking the Congress and the country to accept a firm commitment to a new course of action. I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal, before this decade is out, of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the earth.
John Young's job is going to the moon. But 400,000 people behind the scenes really make it all possible. Engineers, scientists, aerospace workers, technicians.
See, my heart's still beating.
Years of rigorous training before landing on the moon.
In the meantime, the lunar module test conductor Fritz Weidecker.
Suiting up with uncomfortable sensors taped to the chest takes a tiresome hour.
And the rover are go. We've just completed our status reports.
Clyde Teague, an integral part of the space team, trains astronauts in the complexities of the spacesuit.
Feels pretty good in arms.
We understand there's an estimate that there are more than a million people in the area here to view the launch. The traffic has been heavy since 2 o'clock this morning. The beaches are packed and the roads are packed. We're monitoring our status board here in Fire.
Cape Kennedy, 1969. Tom Stafford, Gene Cernan, and John Young head for the launch pad in a trip around the moon. The last rehearsal flight before the first moon landing.
Sequences continuing. We now have second stage liquid oxygen and third stage liquid oxygen. We have complete clearance to launch. We are go. Engines on. 3, 2, 1. All engines running. Launch commence. Liftoff. We have liftoff at 9:34 a.m. Eastern Daylight Time.
Rocket's roar is left behind as the spacecraft breaks the sound barrier. In space, the team must function alertly in spite of cramped conditions and frequent sleepless periods. They must adjust as their weight changes abruptly from zero in orbit to a ponderous half ton on re-entry. On the moon, John Young will weigh a mere 30 pounds. To prepare, he trains like an athlete. This 41-year-old keeps in rugged shape, running 2 miles a day at the Manned Space Center in Houston, Texas. But this exercise is only part of his training program. To sharpen their flying reflexes, there is practice in T-38 jets, in helicopters, and in landing training vehicles.
How does it look for tomorrow? You think we have any fog in here?
No, sir. I'm expecting a frontal passer tonight about midnight, and we shouldn't have any problem with fog in the morning.
Got to come back about 8 o'clock. You reckon it'll be...
8 o'clock in the morning?
8 a.m., yeah.
Okay, sir. Have a good trip.
If the first moon mission had not had a human pilot, it would have failed. But Neil Armstrong took over the controls from the computer and avoided a fatal crash.
Yes, sir.
Astronauts, like quarterbacks, make the headlines. But the important work of thousands goes unnoticed, unpublicized, behind the scenes.
Thank you.
Astronauts are equally at home, jetting through the sky at 800 miles per hour, or racing above the sky at 18,000 miles per hour.
Here we get a word.
While in such an orbit, they check all systems before boosting away from Earth toward the moon. Escape from Earth takes only a few minutes of firing. Later, the moon's gravity will take over, tugging them silently through space. Back in Houston is the center where astronauts train and where the control room buzzes with activity during the mission. 100 men work here in shifts, day in and day out, checking screens, working computers, advising, calculating. Their role is vital. Doctors monitor astronauts' heartbeats on a screen, blipping from the sensors taped to their chest 100,000 miles away. Unlike airplanes, space vehicles can tumble end over end, moving around three axes at once. And unlike an airport, the moon is a moving target. These men and their computers overcome these navigational obstacles to help the astronauts make a pinpoint landing. All voice communications are handled by astronauts on the ground. John Young did this before, while others were aloft. Vigilance is constant, for all know that even slight errors can result in tragic disaster. Young confers with Tom Stafford, with whom he flew around the moon.
In the developmental stage, in the neck convolute area, you'd...
Colonel Stafford keeps track of all astronaut training and keeps a sharp eye on their flight readiness. Young and Charles Duke report to him about spacesuit improvements.
We've been running some tests on a new suit, Tom, and it looks pretty good. You know, it's the one with waist mobility in it, ACE-MLB. We put it on the centrifuge the other day, and both Charlie and I ran for about 3 miles. We averaged better than 6 feet a second. And I don't guess we ever got up to full speed. We're still looking at it, but it really looks good.
Nice job.
Yeah.
Hey, how about
that? Did y'all get the word I'd like to get it set up so I can run at 6 foot a second and be in the middle? Is that hard to change?
No, all we got to do is crank the boom, adjust the boom.
Okay. Because I've never really gotten up to VMAX in this suit. I'd like to try it this time.
You're talking about only, dude.
All right.
Yes.
Specialists suspend him in a pogo harness attached to the arm of a giant centrifuge. An astronaut in a suit will weigh about 60 pounds on the moon. Exactly reduplicating this requires delicate adjustments.
Looks like then, as far as increased capability, this suit, as far as exploring the lunar surface, this is considerably improvement over what we've had before.
And I think the crew will be better rested, too, with this suit. I think you can do the same.
Other briefings, study, field trips, and mechanical training keep astronauts on the run 14 hours a day, 6 days a week. Today, he lopes around this sandy track for 3 miles. Tomorrow he may be in the centrifuge bell overhead, working spacecraft switches under conditions similar to those in space. Weightlessness is one unique feature of spaceflight. Astronauts find it an exhilarating experience. To play a wondrous slow-motion game of catch, to tumble freely in the air, to float about the cabin like a disembodied spirit. But zero gravity holds many practical applications that will spark discovery in science, medicine, and industry. The equipment in this cavernous room duplicates the final stage of a moon flight. Long rehearsal in this complicated cubbyhole prepares an astronaut for landing on the moon. But before landing, there is the danger involved in entering moon orbit. An improper firing, and the spacecraft could crash into the moon. John Young's description betrays none of the risks involved.
It's really a tremendous thrill to be in orbit around the moon, and the beauty of this, the scene is fantastic. It is not just one hole right after another. There are all kinds of interesting features on it. Rills and lava flows, giant lofty peaks. It's not a simple body from a geologic standpoint.
His confidence has been bolstered by the 1,000 hours he spends in the lunar module simulator, practicing for just one moon landing. He must manipulate 340 switches to which the computers respond as realistically as the spacecraft does. If he turns the switch for right, the dials indicate a pitch to the right. It is even shown on a TV screen connected to a TV camera under an artificial moon surface. The camera moves in three directions, responding exactly to his commands. Playing the part of adversity, the computer engineer purposely makes it veer off course or go out of control. John Young must quickly diagnose the problems and correct them.
We just reset again, John. We're really running right now.
Thanks, guidance.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Man pitted against computer. But when the landing craft actually separates from the command module to begin its descent to the moon, it is man against nature and the danger of the unknown. 10 years of training for this short job. As they drop into this unknown world, the excitement literally sets their hearts pounding.
50 at 3. Cross pointers look good. 25. 2. 7% fuel. 20 at 1. 15 at 1. Minus 1. Minus 1. 6% fuel. 10 feet minus 1. 8 feet minus 1. Contact. Man. Okay, Houston.
On the surface of the moon, the astronauts will work alone. But while training on Earth, expert technicians prepare them in many fields.
Yeah, push the button there on the side, Charlie.
You pressurized, John?
No.
Huh?
Later, while on the moon, they'll be carefully monitored and guided by radio and television. Like actors, astronauts must rehearse each task to memorize perfection. As in a schoolroom with 6 teachers and 2 students, the learning is concentrated and intensive. By intercom, the technicians teach them to operate TV, still, and motion picture cameras.
ECB matches it. Off close.
On the bottom of that, we'll have to look at that again.
Yep. Okay, we we got the LEC hanging up over there.
To attach special antennas.
Push it back up.
John has adjusted the antenna. Okay, it's up. Houston, we landed somewhere on the moon.
Okay, let's deploy the flag now.
Charlie.
Is that my job?
Yeah,
that's your job,
Charlie. Yahoo!
We'll get the TV on you over there.
Then, how to deploy 12 or more scientific packages, including a magnetic field detector, moonquake detector, and a solar wind experiment. A radio beams the information back to Earth. In the most expensive car ever built, the Lunar Rover, astronauts can explore much farther than they could before on foot. But even this sophisticated car is being continually modified.
Not Velcro, but a strap that you could Velcro right here, say. And then as you pull it across your leg, just Velcro it to the handle.
It just kisses on there and stays there.
And then you can reach over and pull it off and then back over again. It goes. One piece.
And you really need three hands. You need one hand to hold this thing up where you can thread it. You need another hand to bring this thing through there, and then you need another hand to reach over and grab it when you get it through there with only two hands.
What you'd like to have is something with a hook on it, that you could just go up and hook that.
Well, what we really need is
front of it, maybe
it'll
last in fact.
We don't have it.
That's the possible approach. It's hooked there, but all you have to do is pull on it to get it unhooked again. It's got no latch on it or anything.
Down.
Right.
Might work.
Trained in engineering, Young and Duke worked together with these specialists to improve the Lunar Rover.
Now that's a detail, something that will give somehow a spring over there, a spring. Put it
back over there.
Put a spring tension.
Just loop it like this with a spring in, you know.
That is.
We can GFE up and back.
Well, thanks for getting this thing together, you guys.
Okay.
Appreciate
it.
We enjoyed it ourselves.
As a one of many.
Yeah, we'll be seeing you again.
Well, I'm afraid so.
Take it easy.
We'll see y'all. Okay.
Like I said, that's the coarsest grained rock we brought back on Apollo 11.
Already, astronauts have discovered four new minerals not found on Earth. Before a mission, intensive study with geologists, who are among the scientists from over 200 universities involved in the space program.
Pretty clean as they picked them up. The main problem is when they were put in the sample bags, they got dust.
On an earlier mission, astronaut David Scott demonstrated the value of this geology training.
These rounded fragments down here on the order of meters in size expose some very large, 2-3 centimeter vesicles.
This past experience is not lost on John Young.
My question is, are those metallic line vesicles, is that ilmenite that they're lined with? Or is that what it looks like?
No, we know they're ilmenite. You see, but they still sparkle.
Yes. After several days of exploration, collecting rocks, drilling rock samples, and sleeping aboard the lunar module, the astronauts stow away their bounty as we see them practicing here on Earth. They climb aboard and prepare for liftoff.
99 Pro. Good liftoff. Automatic.
The moon's light gravity lets the spacecraft spring away like a fly. Then, rendezvous with the command module in moon orbit.
Hey, good smooth ride, Ed.
At first, a barely perceptible speck. The lunar module grows bigger as it approaches the command module for docking.
Well, what a view of the rail, huh?
Roger, copy now.
Solid, good at 30.
Falcon, you're go at 1 minute.
Right.
Auto start, normal shutdown.
Roger, auto start, normal shutdown. Very nice maneuver endeavor. Hard dock.
Once docked, cameras, film, and moon rocks are transferred into the command module. Days later, 2.5 minutes of firing thrust their craft into a long coast to that distant blue oasis in space called Earth.
The time that we spent going to and from the moon really passed very fast. We had plenty of work to do, and we were doing tests of the navigation system of our spacecraft. We were doing experiments, taking pictures of the Earth,
and having a much-needed shave. Although this three-man ship is much bigger than our first grapefruit-sized satellite, it is still primitive by future standards. And even a 100-man space station like this will seem as crude to our grandchildren as the first airplane seems to us. On the immediate horizon is Skylab. Already being built, it will carry three men in orbit for weeks at a time. This space laboratory, as big as a house, is a lively topic of discussion in Houston.
And, now we've got 11,000 cubic feet throughout the whole thing.
In the astronaut library, John Young discusses Skylab with three other space veterans. Charles Conrad, third man on the moon. Walter Cunningham.
That's right, you almost get
and Alan Bean, fourth man on the moon.
Though, and that's easier to carry than...
We're going to get, for the 9 months lifetime, we're going to get all of our energy from these solar cells, John.
And what's bothering me in looking at the 100-man space station is that whole thing is oriented, you know, we shouldn't have doors like that anymore.
No.
Conrad because, and then Bean will command the first two teams to go aloft in Skylab. Later, an enormous space shuttle will take satellites into orbit and transport scientists of any age into space. It will be reusable 100 times and land at a normal airport. But until that time, awkward and expensive methods bring our astronauts home. Re-entry today must be precise. Entering the atmosphere at too steep an angle will burn the spacecraft to a crisp. Too shallow an angle, and the spacecraft will skip off the atmosphere like a stone, never to return. The total recovery force now required, 4 ships, 38 planes, 3,000 men. Despite a broken parachute, splashdown is successful. John Young, an early breed of space traveler, an astronaut. His work and the work of many thousands more will enable restless, curious man to travel to Mars, and eventually, perhaps, to more distant destinations.